Can you hear me? Thank you. Let's start today's class. So, the previous time, so we learned about the hazard detection unit and folding unit. So, then I explained that the folding unit is required to reduce the data, the performance degradation by data hazard. And then, even though we use the data folding unit, we cannot eliminate the data hazard totally because there is some data hazard that cause the performance degradation. That is the load use hazard. So if the load, so if the previous instruction is load instruction, and then the next following instruction is the instruction that use the data loaded by load instruction, then we need to store one clock for the following instruction because the data is read from the data memory, and then this data is not ready when the following instruction is in the EX stage. So actually in this so we are learning about the pipeline architecture, and then I said that the basic concept of the pipeline architecture is very simple, and then I believe that everyone can understand how pipeline works. But the difficult part of this pipeline architecture is something like data folding unit or data hazard unit. So for the data folding unit, so we need to set the conditions that for the data from the previous instruction to the following instruction. Also for the data hazard unit, so we need to detect this hazard condition. Also we need to control the pipeline registers. So that's why so this data folding unit and then data hazard detection unit is a difficult part. So try to understand that this part because it's actually very important and then very critical for understanding the hardware, the pipeline architecture. So then for today's class, we will learn about the control hazard. So what is the control hazard? What is the meaning of the control hazard? So what is the hazard? Hazard. What is the meaning of hazard? The clock cycle, by some reason. No. That's the hazard is just so actually the original meaning of the hazard is just like this. It's like load. It's a load. And then if we encounter some obstacles or some holes, and then that may hinder our works or our what is it, propagation. So that is called the hazard. So actually in the pipelining, the hazard means the clock cycles are wasted by some reason. So, and then by this various reason, we classify the hazard like a structure hazard, data hazard, and control hazard. So you need to remember this because this is the very important part of the pipeline architecture design. So the structure hazard. So if we don't have available hardware resources for executing some instruction, then that is called the structure hazard. So structure hazard happens due to the lack of hardware resources. And then the data hazard. So we learned about the data hazard in the previous class. And then also we learned about this hazard detection unit and the data forwarding unit. So data hazard happens, why? Because of data dependencies among instructions. So what is the data dependency? The data is used by or consumed by following instruction. Then that is called the data dependency, such as A equal B plus C, and then D equal A plus one. Just like this. So this following instruction requires the result from the this former instruction. Okay, so it's called the data dependence. Then what is the control hazard? So clock cycles are wasted due to control instructions such as branches or exceptions. So what is the control instructions? The flow of instruction is changed by a certain instruction, and then that is called the control instructions. So for the normal case, the actually in the normal code, the instruction is executed from top to bottom sequentially, and then also so you are designing the single cycle processor. So for the normal case, the next program counter value is the PC plus four. That is the normal case. But for some reason, we need the control instruction because we frequently use the control statement in C or Python, like if A equal B, then blah, 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 or for I equal zero, I less than 100, I plus plus, that is the iteration loop. So we frequently use this type of statement in our high level language. And then in order to support this statement or instruction, then we need the control instructions such as branch or jump instruction. So if the clock cycles are wasted by this type of instructions, then this hazard is called the control hazard. So today we will learn about the control hazard, and then we will learn how to handle control hazard in the pipeline architecture. Okay, let's see that this flow of instruction in the five-stage pipeline architecture. And this is the instructions, these are instructions, and then as you can see, this is the, what is this? What is this number? This is the PC, right? Program counter. So as you can see, the program counter increases by 4 for the next instruction. So because it is a normal case. So, and then this video shows the how instructions are executed in the five-stage pipeline architecture. And then let us assume that the branch is reserved in EX stage, but this decision is propagated to the memory stage. So the final result is reserved in memory stage. So let's see that this simplified pipeline architecture. So as you can see, when the branch instruction is executed by this processor, five-stage pipeline processor. So actually this processor just supports the BEQ, because in this course we just designed the processor that only support the BEQ instruction for the branch instruction. Okay. So for this BEQ instruction, so I believe everyone is designing a single cycle processor. So for this branch instruction, the branch instruction is executed by ALU, right? The single cycle processor. And then we use the sub operations, subtract operation in ALU for this branch BQ, because we just compare the operands of two registers. So for the branch instruction, the data is read from the register file, two operands are read from the register file, and then this data is compared using sub in ALU. So if the value is the same, then the result of the subtraction will be zero. So the zero is detected here, and as the result of the ALU. So if you actually in the lab assignment two, you're requested to design ALU. So and then I believe so you this ALU includes the zero output. So that means the if the zero is detected in the ALU result, then this output becomes one. I believe everyone remembers. So this result of the branch instruction is propagated to the memory stage because when the result is determined, is reserved, then the delay of the ALU is included. So that means this result will be generated at the rate of the 1 clock period. So this is the clock period, and then because of the delay of the ALU, the result will be reserved at this point, the late part of the 1 clock cycle. So the result is propagated to the memory, and then if the branch is true, so this control signal is also generated by control unit, and then this result is feedback to this selection port of this multiplexer. Okay, so the branch result is reserved, so that means it's determined in memory stage, and then is delivered to this multiplexer. So at the next rising edge of this clock signal, the target of the branch is updated to the PC register. Okay. This figure explains the behavior of this branch instruction. So the CC1, this is the clock cycle number one, the branch BQ instruction is fetched from the instruction memory by PC number 40. Okay. And the next cycle, the PC will be 44. Right? So, and then by this PC, this program counter number, the next instruction is fetched from the instruction memory. So end is here, and where is the branch? So BQ is in the ID stage. And then for the next sec, the CC number three, clock count number three, the PC becomes the 48. That is the next PC. And then OR instruction is fetched from the instruction memory, and then end instruction is in the ID stage, because it's propagated to the ID stage. And where is the branch? Branch is in the EX stage, right? So when the branch instruction is in the EX stage, the subtraction is performed for the branch instruction. And then if x1 is equal to x0, then the zero becomes the one. Okay. And then for the next scale, but because of the delay of ALU, this result cannot be given to the is the delivered to the program counter. So we just propagate this result to the memory stage at CC4. It's a memory stage. So branch is in the memory stage. And then at this time, the end is here, or is here, and then the add is here. So, and then this, what is the control signal? This PC source control signal. The branch is in the memory stage, PC source becomes the one, and then this given to the program counter. And then next stage, because the PC source becomes one at this memory stage, when the branch instruction is at the memory stage, then this is the PC, and then this is the mark, and then it's the PC source, and then this is the 0, 1, it's a PC plus 4, and then the PC by branch, so target of the branch. So because PC source becomes 1, this input is selected by this multiplexer, and then PC receives the PC by branch. Okay. Actually, in the single cycle processor design, this is the PC next to maybe branch, the name of this signal. So, and then at the rising edge of the clock, then the PC is updated by PC by branch. So this is the target of the branch. And then, so what is the target of this branch? It's a 40 plus 32, because it's a 16 multiplied by 2, is 72. So this PC becomes the 72 when at CC5, okay? So new instruction. Not next instruction, the instruction pointed by this branch instruction, the target of the branch instruction is fetched at CC5. So how many cycles are wasted by this branch instruction? How many cycles? Right, because by this branch instruction, we need to flush these three instructions. So that means we waste the three cycles. So when the branch instruction is taken, that means that the condition of the branch is true, then the three cycles are wasted. That is called the branch the control hazard by branch instruction, okay? Sometimes it's called the branch hazard, but it's called the control hazard, okay? So actually this wasted cycle is a huge, actually. So you may think, oh, it's just the three cycles, but it can be very huge, because let's think about the for instruction, like iteration loop for I equal 0, I is less than 100, I plus plus. And then some instructions are statements are repeated, and then at the end of this for loop. So actually this for loop, this part is repeated 100 times, but that means the branch instruction is located at the end of this loop, and then this branch is taken. So it is returned to the the start point of the, this for loop. So for this statement, the branch is taken 100 times. And then whenever the branch is taken, the this pipeline process pipeline, the processor will waste 3 cycles. It's the huge performance degradation. Okay. So we need to reduce the waste of clock cycles by control hazard. So in this class, so we just modify the data path of the branch instruction like BQ. Okay. So let's for the this branch instruction, the BQ instruction, what's the operation of the this BQ instruction? Just first read operands from register file, 2 operands, and then performs sub instructions in EXDG, and then just check the result is 0 or not. So, but we just compare the equivalence equality of the these 2 operands by this branch instruction. So we just use the sub instruction, but for the binary data, we can use exclusive OR to detect the equality of 2 bits, right? How? For the exclusive OR gate, A, B, C, so C is the output. If the 2 inputs are all 0, C becomes the 0. And then 0, 1, it becomes the 1, 1, 0, it becomes 1, and then 1, 1 is a 0. So for the 2-bit inputs, for the exclusive OR, exclusive OR generate 1 if the 2 bits are different to each other. Otherwise, the result of the exclusive OR, it becomes the 0. So if we use the exclusive OR gate, we can easily and then very quickly compare the 2 values. And then for the subtract operation, so you may need some knowledge in the system design for this to understand this part. But for the sub instruction, this is the adder actually. So for the sub or add operation, the carry is propagated from the LSB to the MSB. And then because of this carry propagation, the add or sub will take a very long time. But for the bitwise exclusive OR, so we just need the bitwise exclusive OR to compare the 2 data, 2 binary data. And then this comparison can be executed in parallel. Because, for example, if the data is the 4-bit data, like 00001111, then we can just apply the exclusive OR for each pair of bits. Then this can be done concurrently. So, 패러럴하게 될 수 있다는 거예요. So, it will take very long, very short time. Okay? So, actually, if we just check the equivalence of the 2 binary data, then we can just use the exclusive OR, and then we can just check the all zeros of this exclusive OR. So we can make the very quick, very fast, and the simple comparator for the binary data. And then this comparator can locate in ID stage because the data is read from the register file, the 2 data, 2 operands for BQ instruction can be read from the register file. And then by this simple comparator, these 2 operands can be compared very quickly. And then this result can be given to the program counter in instruction fetch station. So instead of resolving branch, the result of the branch instruction in memory stage, then we can reserve the result of the branch instruction in ID stage. Okay, do you understand? So like this. So what is different? The comparator is here, okay? And then this comparator receives two inputs from the output of register file. And then this comparator just compares the two binary data from register file, okay? So in the previous example, when the branch is taken, the three time cycles are wasted because these three cycles are wasted here. But for this enhanced design, the branch is reserved in ID stage. Then when the branch is taken, only one cycle is wasted. Why? When the branch is in the big the BQ, this branch is in the ID stage, then the result of this branch instruction is reserved. And then when the branch is in the ID stage, the very next instruction and is in the instruction fetch stage. And then this result of the branch is given to the program counter, and then in the next at the next cycle, the BQ is in the EX stage, but this result is already given to the program counter. So program counter is updated by target of the branch instruction, so 72 in the previous example. So this new target of the branch instruction, load, is fetched, and then this end is the flushed because this is the long instruction. Understand? So only one cycle is wasted by this branch instruction. Okay. So as I explained, this is the enhanced design of the five-stage pipeline architecture for branch instruction. So comparator is here, and then as you can see, the target of the branch is also computed in ID stage. How? This is the immediate generator, and then immediate generator generate immediate values from the instruction. And then shift to left one because for the branch instruction of the RISC file, when the immediate value is shifted left by 1 bit because it's multiplied by 2. So this immediate value, shifted immediate value, is added to the program counter of the BEQ. This is the program counter of the BEQ, right? And then the 72 is generated here. So when the branch is here, the two operands are compared, and then the target address is also computed, okay? So and then this target address is given to this mux, and then the branch is true, then the PC source is also becomes the one, okay? And then when the branch is taken, the following instruction, this end instruction should be flushed because this is the incorrect instruction. So this end instruction, as you can see, this end instruction is the very very next instruction of the branch instruction, and then but this branch is taken, so the PC is changed to the target of the branch instruction. So this end instruction is incorrectly fetched. So incorrectly fetched instruction should be flushed. That's why we need the flush control signal for the IF ID pipeline register. Okay? Yeah, understand? Okay, so the next instruction, the branch instruction is in the EX stage, but it will do nothing. And then bubble is here because this, but when the branch is taken, the if.flush becomes the one, becomes one. So this end instruction is flushed. So if the instruction is flushed, then it will become bubble or nope. And then the new instruction, the target of the branch instruction is fetched. So by this enhanced design, only one cycle is wasted because only one bubble is generated. Understand? Okay. Okay. I hope everyone understands. Okay. Okay. And then let's learn about the branch prediction. So actually when the branch is taken, then it will, this pipeline processor will waste only one cycle. But this is the very simple pipeline design. So, and then the number of stages of this pipeline processor is just 5. But in the real design or real pipeline architecture, the number of the depth of the, it is called the number of pipeline stage is called the depth of the pipeline architecture. And then this depth of the pipeline architecture is very deep. So that means in the commodity hardware, the number of pipeline stage is larger than 5. Usually it's a commercial processor. Why? So why do we use the pipeline architecture? So first reason to use the pipeline architecture is to cut the critical path of digital design. Yeah, right. 성능을 향상시키기 위해서. So that means if we increase the number of stages of this pipeline architecture, then we can just decrease the delay of the critical path more. So then we can use the faster clock, right? So that's why we use the deeper pipeline architecture, so deeper. But what's the problem? So in the deeper pipeline architecture, the penalty of the branch instruction can be higher. So that's why. When the branch is taken, the following instructions, the very next instructions of this branch instruction should be flushed, so it's nullified. So that means if the branch is reserved later, then the number of flushed instruction will be increased. And then if the pipeline is deeper, then this instruction will be the number of flushed instructions will be larger. So branch penalty can be higher for the commercial processor. And then in order to reduce this penalty, so that means the control hazard by branch instruction, then we can add the branch prediction. So, what is the prediction? So, if we say about the prediction, then it's very similar to the weather forecast, or sometimes it is very similar to the stock prediction. 주식하고 사실 비슷하죠. So, how can we predict the future event? Like, so, the prediction is that the prediction is just expect the result of the future event. And then how the prediction works, we can monitor the behavior of previous result, and then based on this monitored previous result, then we can predict the future event. And then, for example, for the weather forecasting, we just monitor some previous weather result, like fine. If the weather is fine, then we can just predict that, oh, tomorrow the weather will be fine. It's like that. The branch can be also predicted using the same way, because if the branch is taken, then we can expect that the future branch will be taken also. Okay, so that is the branch predictor. If we predict the result of the branch instruction, then we can reduce the penalty by this branch instruction. Okay, and then this is called the dynamic branch prediction. So 네. The one student ask a question before the exclusive or this source 어떻게 감지되나요? 네, 뭐죠? bit간 exclusive or를 하면 우리가 이제 comparator인데 이게 이제 comparator가 exclusive or를 이제 bit by bit 한 다음에 all 0를 detection을 하면 돼요. 만약 예를 들어서 A가 0000, B가 0000였다. 이게 A exclusive or와 B를 하면은 이거 어떻게 되죠? 0000가 되죠? 모든 빛이 0라는 거를 디텍션을 하면 됩니다. 요거는 근데 우리가 어쨌든 디지털 시스템 디자인을 들었으면 알 텐데 NAND 게이트를 쓰면은 all 0는 아주 쉽게 디텍션 할수 있어요. 왜냐면 all 0가 되면은 NAND는 1이 나오니까. 그래서 1이 되면은 브랜치 인스트럭션이 브랜치고 그다음에 여기서 컴패레이터 결과가 1이 나왔다면은 PC 소스가 1이 되겠죠. 그렇지 않고 뭐 하나가 여기 1이 됐다, 뭐 0001이다 하면은 내가 0001이 되겠죠. 익스클루시브 OR 하면은 그 낸드를 하면은 얘는 0이 될 거고요. 그러면 브랜치가 1이지만 리졸트가 0이니까는 얘는 PC 소스가 0이 되겠죠. 이렇게 됩니다. 이렇게 하면 됩니다. 그냥 됐나요? 오케이. 어디 와이어를, 아, 여기는 지금 그 빠져 있어요. 여기, 지금 여기서는 이게 지금 여기 지로가 이렇게 들어가 있고, 그 다음에 요 컨트롤에서 된 여기 브랜치가 이제 들어가 있는데, 이 부분이 역시나 여기로 갔다라고 이제 보면 됩니다. 오케이. So let's see how can we implement the branch predictor. So I explained that for the branch prediction, we just monitor the previous result of the branch instruction. So, for example, what is BQ? For this BQ, we can monitor the behavior of this BQ. So the previous result of this BQ instruction is true, that means the taken, then we can just expect that for the next branch instruction, for the same instruction, then this branch can be taken. The not taken is the not taken. So for this branch prediction, we just check the one previous event of a certain branch instruction. So we just check the one previous event. And then based on this one previous event, then we just expect the future event of this branch instruction. So this is called the one-bit predictor. So why we use the bit predictor? Because the result of the branch instruction is just taken or not taken. So that means it's true, it's false. It's just there are two cases for the result of the branch instruction. And then we can represent this result with the bit, so binary data, one bit. So one bit predictor means that for this branch predictor, we just check the one previous result of the branch instruction. So let's see the behavior of the full iteration loop, like a for I equal 0, I is less than 100, I plus plus. So I said that this for iteration loop can be represented by branch instruction, and the branch instruction is located at the last part of this iteration loop. So when this branch is taken, the PC is updated by the target of the branch instruction. That means the PC is restored to the first part of this statement inside of the for iteration loop. So that means if this for iteration loop is executed, and then as you can see, it will be repeated 100 times. So what is the behavior of this branch instruction, like BTS BQ instruction? It's taken, 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 taken. And then it will be taken 99 times, and then it will not be taken one time among 100 branch instructions. Do you understand? So for this iteration loop, if the branch is taken here, then we can expect for the next iteration, the branch will be also taken. Then if this is predicted as taken, then our prediction is right. And then it is called the hit. So it's called the hit because it's called the hit case, because our prediction is matched to the real events of the branch instruction. Okay. But for some iteration loop, this the hit rate, so that means the successful rate can be lower for this one bit predictor. Like this double nested iteration loop. Okay. So in order to cope with the behavior of this nested iteration loop, then we can use the two-bit predictor. So this figure shows how two-bit predictor works. So for this two-bit predictor, the two-bit predictor has just checked the two previous result two previous events, and then these two previous events can be represented as the two bits because the event of the branch instruction is true or false. Okay, and then this is a state of the two bit predictor, and then this two bit, the state of a two bit predictor works like a saturated counter. So like this state is the 00, so that means that that is false case, and then 01 is the false true case, 10 true or false case, and then 11. So the state change like this. If the count state is 00, and then if the branch is not taken, then it's the 00 on state. And then if the branch is taken, that means the previous branch event is the one, and then the previous of a previous branch, maybe the event is the 0. So this is called the 01. But for this two-bit predictor, if the state is 01, then it is predicted as the not taken. But if the when the current state is the 01, and then if the branch is taken, then state is changed to the 10. And then for this state, the future branch instruction will be predicted as taken. So taken, so not taken. So this is how the 2-bit branch predictor works. So there are four states for this 2-bit predictor. And then based on the event of the branch instruction, the states are changed. And then these two states, the state number 00 and then state number 01 is when the branch instruction is in the state number 00 or 01, then the branch, the future branch instruction will be predicted as not taken, so not taken. And then if the current branch instruction is in the 11 or 10 state, then the future branch instruction will be predicted as taken. Okay, understand? So, and then there can be many branch instructions in the code. Okay, like for the PC number 40, there is the BQ, and then PC number 52, there is the BQ also. And then these states of the predictor is assigned to the each branch instruction. Okay. So, for example, this is the branch instruction by PC number 40, and this is the branch instruction by PC number 42. And then for this branch instruction, the computer processor just assigns a 2-bit for the branch predictor. And then these 2 bits are assigned to this branch instruction. And then for this branch instruction, for PC number 42, the another 2 bits are assigned. So you can just separate the behavior of the different branch instruction for the branch predictor, okay? Yeah, 이 branch predictor는 사실은 좀 어려울 수가 있긴 한데 그래도 어떤 식과는 각각의 bit이 the each branch instruction has each bit, for the 1-bit predictor, each branch instruction has 1 bit. And then for the 2-bit predictors, each branch instruction have 2 bits. And then these bits, the state of the branch is changed by the result of the branch instruction. And then based on this bit result, the future branch instruction, the event, future branch instruction event is predicted. 그러니까 각각의 branch instruction마다 prediction bit이 이제 할당이 되고요. 그 prediction 빛의 상태에 따라서 이 브랜치 인스트럭션은 어떻게 될 것이다. 이 브랜치 인스트럭션은 어떻게 결과가 될 것이다. 이거를 우리가 이제 예측을 한다. 이렇게 보면 되겠습니다. 오케이. But for the five-stage pipeline processor, even we can use the branch predictor to get but the target we just have the one cycle penalty by take branch instruction. Why? Because the target of the branch instruction is also determined in id staging. So when the branch instruction is like this is the instruction fetch, instruction decode, EX stage. When the branch instruction is in the instruction fetch stage, like and then let us assume that the program count of this branch instruction is 40. And then also, as I mentioned, the two bits are assigned to this branch instruction. These two bits are pointed by program count of this branch instruction. So if we know the PC of the branch instruction, the PC of the branch instruction, and then if we know this is the branch instruction, then we can read the branch predictor bits assigned to the this branch instruction. We can just read the these two bits stored in the branch predictor by program count of the branch instruction. But so we can predict the result of the branch instruction like true or not taken or not taken. What's the problem? We don't know the target of the branch because the target of the branch instruction is included in the its own instruction. And then in the as you can see, the target of the branch instruction is also calculated in id stage. So if the target is calculated in id stage, then even though we use the branch predictor, then if the branch is taken, then one cycle is wasted. Oh, there is no benefit by branch predictor. So what is required? We need the branch target buffer. It's called the BTB. So what is the branch target buffer? So branch target buffer just store the target of the branch instruction. What do you mean? If you see that this BQ instruction, so we can just easily calculate that the target of the branch instruction of this BQ is the 72, right? And then this target of the branch instruction is constant for each branch instruction, right? Because this immediate value is the constant value for this branch instruction. And then actually PC is the same. The PC is also constant for this BQ instruction. So constant plus constant is constant. So when this branch instruction is taken, then the target of this BQ will be 72 always. So if we know once this target of the branch is computed, then we can reuse this computed value for the next or future branch instructions, right? Because target is the same. So we can add the branch target buffer and then pick this branch target buffer just to store the target of the this previous the branch instruction, and then so target is stored in the here, and then when the branch is fetched by this program counter. This target value is also fetched by this program counter value of the branch instruction. And then, so we can just know the target of the branch instruction in instruction fetch stage. Okay, so by doing this, we can remove the penalty by take branch instruction. Okay. 네, 사실 뭐 좀 어려운 컨셉이긴 한데, 어쨌든 프레딕터가 인스트럭션 패치 스테이지에 존재하고, 그 다음에 요 브랜치 타겟 버퍼, 타겟 버퍼도 여기 인스트럭션 패치 스테이지에 존재해서, 요거를 이제 프로그램 카운터를 읽어서 그를 바로 프레딕션 된 것과, 그 다음에 요 타겟을 가지고서 바로 넥스트 타겟 오브 더 브랜치로 가서 바로 패치를 하겠다. 이것이 이제 기본 아이디어입니다. 사실 쉽지는 않은데, 그래도 이게 중요한, 뭐랄까. 어쨌든, 이 파이프라인드 아키텍처에서 이제 크리티컬한 거는 해저드를 어떻게 줄일 수 있느냐, 이게 제일 크리티컬해요. 그래서 나오는 아이디어들이 이제 뭐 데이터 포딩 유닛, or the branch predictor, or branch target, 이런 것들이 나오는 건데, 어쨌든 그런, 이런, 헬저들을 어떻게 줄일 것이냐, 이런 것들을 뭐 잘 이해를 하면은 좋을 것 같습니다. 오케이. So, it may be difficult, but try to understand, and try to read the textbook for the branch target or branch predictor buffer. Then let's see the exception. So what is the exception in the computer processor? So, yeah. So, I received one question. So, 예측이 틀린 경우에는 버퍼 아니죠? 요 branch target buffer랑 branch predictor는 PC로 요게 selection이 돼요. 그러니까 PC라는 거는 그 branch instruction이 가지고 있는 PC고요. 그러니까는 요 PC는 뭐 딱 정해져 있는 거기 때문에 여기서 그 타겟하고 그 다음에 요 prediction 빛을 읽어와서 결정을 하면 됩니다. 근데 뭐 예측이 틀리면은 다시 해야죠. 예측이 틀리면은 이제 그거는 왜 예측이 틀렸, 그러니까는 예측이 우리가 항상 맞는 건 아니기 때문에 틀릴 수도 있으니까 그럴 때는 다시 플러시를 시켜야죠. 걔가 잘못 패치가 됐으니까 그 다시 이제 그 뭐라 그럴까, 잘못 패치가 된 인스트럭션은 플러시 시키고 다시 이제 제대로 된 값으로 이제 그 패치를 다시 진행을 해야 되는 거죠. 이해가 되나요? 네. 이렇게 그래서 I will explain about that. I will explain how exceptions are handled by pipeline processor. So let's see what is exception and let's see the meaning of exceptions and interrupt. So what is the meaning of the exception? In Korean, exception is the 예외. 예외라고 하죠, 우리가. 그래서 사실은 한글책 보면 다 예외 처리 뭐 이런 식으로 나와 있습니다. 그 exception을 우리가 예외 뭐 상황에서 exception is just the unexpected event that happens in the computer processor. So what is the example of the exception? For example, divided by zero. So if we just a equals 1000, b equals 0, and then c equals a divided by b, then it can generate the exception because there is no right there. Actually, when the certain value is divided by the non-zero value, not non-zero, if a non-zero value is divided by 0, then there is no answer. So computer also cannot calculate this case, and then this is actually the unexpected case, this will generate the unexpected result, then computer processor can report the exception. Okay, so this is the unexpected event. And the unexpected event means that this event will happen rarely. Okay, so if a certain event happens rarely, normally this event is handled by software, because if this event is frequently happens, then the frequently happening event can be handled by hardware, because if the event is handled by hardware, it can handle quickly. But if a certain event happens rarely, then it can be handled by software. Okay. But how do you need to support the exception cases? Why? Because the hardware detect the exception cases, and then how do you report this exception case to the software? And then the software receives this exception report, receive this exception result, then software just calls the exception handler. Okay. So let's see let's take the example of the divide by zero. So A equal 100, 1000, B equal zero, and then C equal A divided by B. And then this will be translated into the machine code, so machine language code, and then the computer processor will execute the translated instructions. And then by this statement, the computer processor encounters exception, divided by zero exception. That means the computer processor cannot generate the correct result. This is the exception case. So the computer processor figure out which type of exception happens in the computer hardware, the computer processor, and then the computer processor just report this exception cases to the software, usually operating system. And then the computer processor calls exception handler. So this exception handler is usually defined in operating system. So for example, if the divided by zero exception happens in the processor, then the operating system receives this exception code from the computer processor, and then just learn the exception handler. And then if the exception is not recoverable, it means this exception is very critical, then the operating system just stop the execution of this code. Okay, and then this process is all defined in exception handler. It's the kind of software. Okay, so the exception handler is defined in software, but the computer hardware need to support the exception detection, and then computer hardware need to support how the exception is handled in the hardware. Okay, so this is the example of the exceptions. Also, another type of exception is the interrupt. Okay, so and then this interrupt is usually caused by input and output devices. So for example, if we push the key of the keyboard, then this is a very rare case actually, because the human's behavior is very slow compared to the computer processor. So that means it's rare. So if an interrupt happens, then so if we push the key of the keyboard, then the signal is given to the operating system. The operating system just stop the execution of the some the current process and then just handles this interrupt. Okay. So for example, if we just push the key, then we can see the which key is pushed, and then the key is displayed in the screen. So this is the example of the interrupt handling. And then this is so kind of very similar to the exception because it's very rare case. So this is called the interrupt handler. So that means that the interrupt, if the interrupt happens, the interrupt handler is also called. And then this interrupt handler is the kind of software. So but actually this is very similar to the function call. Okay? So it's very similar to the function call. So if the exception happens, then the exception is detected, then exception handler. Is called. So I said it's called. It's very similar to the procedure calling. Okay. So let's see how the exception is handled. But the some difference is that the exception, the kind of exception should be reported to the software. And then also the exception is the rare case and it is the unexpected case. So when the function is called, then this function call is supported by instructions like jump or jump and link. But exception is the unexpected case. So we need to, the hardware need to also detect the which kind of exception happens in the processor. Also, the hardware need to store the hardware need to store the return address of the return address from the exception handler. So this is the sequence of the instruction, and then let us assume that exception is encountered at this point. So then the hardware detects the kind of exceptions, and then the exception handler is called. So I said that the exception handler is just a software. Then it jumps to the exception handler here. So the code in the exception handler is executed. And then if this exception type is recoverable, then the processor need to resume the its own code, original code. From where? From the next instruction of where the exception happens, the very next instruction. So in order to return from the exception handler, the processor need to know the return address, and then this return address is stored in the SCPC. It's the special register for handling exceptions. Also, as I mentioned, the processor needs the kinds of exceptions, and then this kind of exception is stored in the SCOS register. It's the also special purpose register in processor. Okay. So And then let's see how the exceptions are handled in the pipeline processor. Okay. So exception handling, I said that the exception handling is very similar to the function call. And then it's also when the exception is, exception happens, then this is the very rare case or unexpected case, though it can be error, it can be an error. So the following instructions should be canceled. So in the pipeline processor, in the method system, that there are five states. So instruction fetch, ID, EX, MEM, and the write back. And then if exception happens in the EX stage, then the following instructions in instruction fetch and add stage should be flushed. That means canceled. How about the formal instructions? The formal instructions should be completed. So when exception happens, first the formal instruction need to complete each operation, and then the following instruction must be flushed. Okay. And then the exception handler should be called by the processor. And then the program counter of the instruction that encounters exceptions should be stored in the SCPC. And then the kind of exception is also stored in the S-codes. Okay. So if that is the pipeline structure that supports the exception handling, and then as you can see, it's more complicated. So actually, exception is the very rare case, but how do you need to support these exception cases? Then that to support the exception, and the hardware need to support some flush of the pipelines, and then also it need to support the core of the exception handler. So as you can see, this hardware has the two special purpose registers like S-codes and SCPC, and then as you can find the more flushing control signals here. Okay. Let's see the example of how handle exceptions are handled. So this is the example code, and then method such that the exception happens in add instruction, the EX stage. And then that is the exception handler code. So I said that exception handler is also the software, that is the software code. And then this is the PC of the exception handler. Then as you can see, this is the instruction of the handler, exception handler. So add is here, add instruction is here, then the exception happens. Then as I mentioned, this pipeline processor need to complete the formal instruction. What are the formal instructions? OR instructions and AND instruction. So these instructions need to complete its own operation. And then the add instruction is here, the exception happens here. Now, the following instructions should be flushed. These instructions should be canceled. So add instructions here. So when the exception is detected, then this special purpose register, the cause of the exceptions, and then the PC of the what's that? Each add instruction is stored in the scores and SCPC, and then these instructions are flushed. So, and then also this add instruction is also need to be flushed, because this can be the error case. It's the very rare case, unexpected case. It can be a error case. So this add instructions should be also canceled. So because it can be a error case. And the next cycle, the OR instruction is in the write backstage. And then as you can see, the handler code is fetched. And then you can find the three buffers. So LD load instruction, sub instruction, and add instructions are flushed. Then this instruction will be executed. How the exceptions are handled in the pipeline stage, pipeline processor. Okay. Yeah. 사실 exception은 사실 역시나 좀 어려운 케이스긴 해요. 특히나 이제 뭐 사실 그런데 이제 하드웨어적으로도 좀 서포트를 해야 되고 이게 레어한 케이스긴 한데 좀 하드웨어 설계를 할 때는 좀 중요한 뭐 이슈긴 합니다. 그렇지만 뭐 레어하기 때문에 이렇게 좀 뭐랄까 메인스트림은 아닌데 메인스트림은 아니지만 그래도 서포트는 해야 된다. 예. 네. 그래서 so we conclude the pipeline architecture. Okay, and then I hope everyone can understand how a pipeline works in the process of design and so as I mentioned, the basic concept of the pipeline architecture is very simple, but there are very famous idioms like "악마는 디테일에 있다." 예, 그런 게 있는데. 영어로 어떻게든 까먹었다. 예. But the details are very complex. That's the problem. So in order to support the data forwarding or hazard detection and control hazard, then the structure and then the hardware or control of the test pipelining is very complex. 예. 그래서 사실 파이프라인의 컨셉은 굉장히 쉬운데 이게 여러 가지 더 레어 그 코너 케이스들 뭐 이런 해저 디텍션이라든지 이런 거 있잖아요. 뭐 익셉션까지 포함해서 이런 코너 케이스를 이렇게 서포트를 잘 하기 위해서 이게 디테일이 굉장히 이제 복잡해지는 그런 이슈가 있습니다. 예. 네, 그런 게 있고요. 그렇지만은 잘 이해를 하면 좋겠고요. 왜냐면 이게 굉장히 기본적인 디자인이에요. 그 컴퓨터 프로세서라든지 이런 거 이해를 할 때 굉장히 기본적인 디자인이기 때문에 잘 이해를 하면 좋겠습니다. 그리고 이제 역시나 그 마지막 그 랩 어사인먼트를 위해서도 여러분들이 잘 이해를 해야 돼요. 네, 질문 있나요? 네. 네, 그러면은 뭐, so I'll stop here and thank you for listening. And then if you have any questions or issues, then post your questions on the Piazza and then we will answer. Okay, thank you.